Okay, so good morning again. We are talking about gear tribology. So what are important things in gears that as a tribologist we should take care of, or at least in the design stage as well as during the performance we should take care of these issues with gears. So the design of gears requires avoiding wear of the gear addendum and detendum areas. So we should be aware of this part, that how the wear will take place. So we should provide the solution against wear. So for example, hardening, keeping the surface very hard is one solution. Another solution is, for example, removing the any dirt particles. So cleanliness of the gear train or gear device is very, very important. There are many other things we have talked about: lubrication, providing EHL solution. So providing enough lubrication so that hydrodynamic lubrication or elastohydrodynamic lubrication can be maintained. Then we should avoid pitting due to Hertzian contact pressure. So Hertzian contact pressure is generated because of very high contact stress, and this Hertzian contact pressure will lead to fatigue problems. So pitting is basically an issue of subsurface fatigue. So when the stresses are very high in the subsurface and it is in cyclic manner, then it leads to pitting. Plastic deformation of gear teeth. So this is because of the strength or high load. So when the load is too high and strength of the gear material is high load, and when the strength of the gear material is not enough, then plastic deformation will take place. Gear teeth breakage due to fatigue loading. So this is also because of high cyclic stress. So to avoid this, we can increase the strength of the gear material as well as improve the toughness. Corrosive wear, we should avoid the corrosion of the gear material, especially in process plants, refineries. The corrosive medium is all around in the industry, and therefore we have to protect the gear material against corrosion. Then third body abrasion is part of the abrasive wear. This can take place because of the dirts, sand particles coming in. So these are the issues that we have to think about while designing the gears. And the factors which affect gear life are load. So we have to look at the load issue. If load is too much, then that may be the cause of failure. Load distribution or alignment issues. Then we should also look at the material part, the toughness of the core of the gear material, and the hardness of the surface, the case hardening. Then temperature. The temperature may be too high in the gear mesh. So that temperature can be reduced by supplying constant flow of lubricants. So lubricant film thickness is also important, and gear tooth geometry. So these are the main design issues that we should be thinking about. And one important thing in gears is the case hardening of the gears, because case hardening can be used to provide small size and better power transmission. So most of the mobile systems like cars and so on, they all have case hardened gears. So case hardening can be carburizing or nitriding. So these are the two important ones. And there are other methods also for surface hardening. And generally the hardness of the surface will be in the range of 55 to 60 HRC. So HRC is the Rockwell hardness number, and the range is in this range, whereas the core will be in the range of 30 to 40 HRC for the core, and this is for the case. So in the next part we will talk about some of the wear and failure mechanisms, or how they fail, and because by studying the failure we can make the design better, and that is how we improve design. Design is not a one-way process, because you design something, you see the performance, and then you watch the failure, how it failed, and then you redesign this machine. So that is how we can learn. So therefore failure part is very, very important. So how the wear takes place in gears? So first type of wear is called polishing wear. So polishing wear is a slow wearing in. In this case, the asperities are worn out, giving very smooth polished surface. So initial polishing wear may be a good thing, good for the gear. Why can you say why initial polishing can be a good thing for gears?
Sir, because sir, in micro level sir, there is lots of scratching and all. So yeah. When we giving the initial wear, that's removed very easily.
Right. So the asperities are removed, and because of initial wearing in, the contact area can be increased, and increased contact area will lead to low pressure, low stress, low contact stress. So good for surface, gear surface provides good conformity and reduces the localized stresses. So initial polishing wear is good thing, provided it doesn't further lead to more wear if the gear stops. So generally what we do is after the initial gear, then you can do a lubricant change, so that all the initial dirt particles or all the wear particles will be removed during the initial part, and then you replace the old oil or lubricant with a new one. So this is often done for a new machine, like if you buy a new car or even a new bicycle, and after some use you will see that the bicycle, the performance has changed, and then it is time that you replace the lubricant and make it afresh. So polishing wear is the initial part, which is good as long as it doesn't lead to further wear, and the next part is called moderate.
Sir, excuse me.
Yeah.
Sir, polishing wear, sir, generally I saw that there is a sandpaper and paper, and we that means through hand we polishing it one.
Yes. So we. Yes, initially we may do the preparation by ourselves, by preparing the surface to make it better and smoother, but this polishing wear happens during the operation, and during the operation it happens at exact places where the stress is, because when we are doing with our own hands, we may not know where the stresses will be acting. So for example, in this part of the gear, the stresses may act at these points. So if it happens during the operation, it automatically polishes at the surface where the stresses are high. So that's why this happens during the operation. Of course, before the operation we try to finish the surfaces as smooth as possible.
So sir, basically we did using our hands or any other equipment?
Yeah, we can for curved surfaces we may have to use our hand to with polishing paper or sometimes with diamond paste we can do the polishing. Okay, but for other kinds of surfaces, flat surfaces, we can use some polishing machine and do the polishing. So yes, so next is the moderate wear. So metal removal from the addendum and detendum areas for a long time, so when the wear continues but at a fixed rate, the rate is not very high and at a fixed wear rate. So this is a usual removal of material which is known as moderate wear, caused by inadequate lubrication and thin lubricant film and the presence of dirt in the lubricants or third body. So this moderate wear is not a good thing, because basically you are losing the material and therefore you are losing the gear performance, because slowly the shape of the gear will change. So this should be avoided, and you can avoid this by changing the viscosity of the lubricant to higher one. So after the initial polishing wear, you can change the lubricant to a higher viscosity one, increasing the speed for hydrodynamic or EHL or EHL film formation, and then filtering the lubricant can be solutions. So increasing the hardness of the gear material is also should also be tried. So these are all part of our redesign of the gear, that next time when we select the material, it should be of higher hardness as well as it should be case hardened. And during the operation, we should take care of the filtration of the lubricant, or changing the lubricant more frequently, and also increasing the speed of the for fluid film formation. So moderate wear will take place over a long period of time during the operation, but this is also something which is damaging and should be avoided, can be avoided. Next is excessive wear. So excessive wear is basically a type of wear which continues from moderate and it goes on for the excessive part. So severe wear takes place in the addendum and detendum part. So for example, if moderate wear is taking place and the shape of the gear has been changed, it is no more involute shape of the gear, then obviously there will be misalignment and there will be vibration. So that will lead to excessive wear. So excessive wear is basically the next stage of the moderate wear. So the involute gear profile gets destroyed, and this is caused because of the failure to notice early wear signs. Pitch line will be prominent and some signs of pitting will also happen. So pittings are also part of like a fatigue because of the hurricane contact stress. So pitting will happen, the addendum and detendum parts will wear out, the shape of the gear will also change. So excessive wear is really very, very damaging, and it will lead to complete failure. So the remedy is same as for moderate wear case, better lubrication direction. So you can have a splash lubrication or feeding the lubricant at the spots, and lubrication filtration should be adopted. So these are the solutions, and either we change the material or change the lubrication system, but we have to do something to avoid excessive wear. And once it goes into the excessive wear, that means the gear is basically going to get damaged very soon. Next is abrasive wear. So in this case, you will see this kind of abrasive marks, continuous marks on one side of the gear. So we are seeing on this side these abrasive marks. So these are basically scratch marks, grooves or lapped finish marks on gear teeth surface, indicates a scratching and material removal by third body wear. So metallic wear debris, weld spatter, scale or rust or sand are the third body that can produce abrasive wear. So cleanliness of the gear environment is very, very important. And that's why all these kind of gears should be packed in a gear box. So if everything is inside a gear box, we can protect them from any kind of third body that is coming from outside, but you may also have third body which was generated inside, for example weld spatter or some metallic wear debris or scale. These will come from inside, so all this should be avoided during the manufacturing and assembly stage. For this as well, oil filtering, high viscosity lubricating oil and frequent oil change are things that we should apply. So oil filtering will remove any abrasive particles. High viscosity lubricating oil will ensure that the film thickness is good enough, so that even if there is some dust particles, it will not damage the surfaces. So for example, if this is the oil film thickness, so smaller dirt particles can remain in the liquid without actually affecting the surfaces. Frequent oil change and maintenance for closed gearbox are the solution. So again, maintaining a gear system is not just something that we do right at the beginning or right at the design stage or manufacturing stage, but there are a lot that should happen during the maintenance, during the performance, like maintaining the cleanliness, maintaining the good oil film and similar kind of solutions. The next is pitting. So pitting is basically formation of a small sort of depressions on the surface. So if this is the surface, small pits are formed, and these pits are results of fatigue, basical fatigue. So high contact stress, and when this contact stress is very localized, then it is more damaging, because at a local point the stress is very very high, and that will lead to pitting. So initial pitting, improper alignment of the teeth. So if the alignment of the teeth is not good, that means the stress is very 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 high at one point. So if this is the total surface of the gear teeth, then and the alignment is not proper, so only this part will be in contact, giving very very high stress, and this part will not be in contact. So therefore alignment is very very important, or errors in the involute profile that can also lead to lot of high stress and sliding. So high stress spots will be created, and that will lead to pitting. This type of pitting stops once the stress and alignment has been even. So this also, initial pitting will happen and slowly it will even out. All the high contact stress parts will be evened out, and therefore the pitting will stop. So for example, in this you can see that typical gear tooth patterns, the first one is good and aligned, and the second one is misaligned. So in the aligned, you see the contact is very very uniform, it starts from here and grows, whereas in the misaligned part the contact is very very high on this side, left side, the right side is lower in contact. So this misalignment should be avoided. Then destructive pitting, this is the result of overload, and the pits are of large sizes, so and forms primarily in the denum area of the gear. So as you can see here, these are very very large pits forming, and this is the destructive, whereas the in the beginning this part you see very very small pits are formed, which may be just a corrective kind of pits. Destructive pitting will lead spoilage of the involute profile, causing rough operation and vibration. This pitting also leads to fatigue, crack initiation and premature breakage of the tooth. So remedy is to reduce the load. So pitting is because of the contact stress, so load should be reduced and increase the hardness of the teeth of the gear, so that the material will take will be able to take the load, especially the driving gear. So pitting is a surface fatigue failure which occurs when the endurance limit of the material is exceeded. A failure of this nature depends on surface contact stress and the number of stress cycles. So basically, by taking care of the loading stress, how the stress is being applied, we can solve the problem of pitting. Spalling, material removal is in large chunks with diameter larger than the pits. So when the removal of the material is very, very severe, as you can see here, it is not just a small pits, but very, very large amount of materials is being removed. So then it is known as spalling. So it is similar to pitting, but the shape is much larger than pitting, and also these kinds of spalled areas are shallower on the surface. Spalling often occurs in medium hard materials as well as in highly loaded, fully hardened materials. So deeper case hardening, so if the material is too soft on the surface, then spalling will happen. So having deeper case hardening and reduction of contact stress can be employed, change of material and clean steel. So for all kinds of surface related, contact stress related failures like pitting and spalling, having clean steel is very, very important. So clean steel basically means no defects or no inclusions, basically no inclusions in the steel. So these inclusions occur because of the impurities like sulfur, phosphorus, nitrogen. So this should be avoided. So if we use clean steel, then the chances are that it will not fail by spalling or pitting. Case crushing. So as we know, the gear surfaces are case hardened. So case hardened means we have got core and we have got a thin layer of case, hard material. Okay. And this case hardening is done by carburizing or nitriding and similar kind of processings. So this is very, very hard, whereas the core is soft. So case crushing happens when this small part of the case gets chipped away. It gets removed, chipped away at the parting line of the core and the case. So the parting line of the core and the case is very, very important, because here there is some stress, residual stress or stress concentration, and therefore cracks can initiate here and it can be dislodged. And therefore, once the case material is dislodged, it becomes a third body, and therefore abrasive wear will take place and it will go into complete failure. So caused by insufficient case depth and high residual stresses at the core case interface. So the case depth should not be very thin, it should be thick enough, and residual stresses should not be high. So that means some sort of annealing or post case hardening heat treatment can help to reduce the residual stresses. Failure often occurs on only one or two teeth of a pinion or gear. The other teeth appear to be undamaged. So this is the nature of case crushing. So case crushing is different from spalling. So we should identify the between the two.
Excuse me, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, in case of pitting, sir. So pitting is always there, no? We cannot avoid pitting, because when two gears in mesh, then there like, so when two gear in mesh, so there is sudden pressure increase when they are in contact, sir.
Yeah, so pitting can happen, as we discussed just now. The initial pitting may be fine. Initial pitting will help to reduce the contact stress, and it is a kind of corrective. So any initial manufacturing error can be corrected by initial pitting. But if pitting leads to further more than initial pitting, then it is not good. So basically, we have to observe whether pitting continues to take place or not. So initial wearing in or initial pitting can be good thing to some extent. Okay, so next is scoring. So scoring is like a rapid wear resulting from a failure of oil film due to overheating of the mesh, permitting metal to metal contact. And this contact produces alternate welding and tearing, which removes metal rapidly from the tooth surface. So basically, if the wear is taking place very, very fast, then there will be metal to metal contact, and there will be some what is known as welding or cold welding. So if such kind of very high adhesion takes place, then welding and then tearing will happen, because the materials have to be removed. They have to separate, and during the separation they will tear out each other. So this is the scoring which damages the gears. So frosting, moderate and destructive scoring. So frosting in the initial scoring gives frosted appearance. So frosted appearance is like a little bit of whitish appearance, just like a frost. If you see in a cold morning, some leaves will be frosted. It will look like that, which are very small pits. So they are also come in the form of pits, but very, very small in size, usually in the detendum area. Moderate scoring produces some radial tear marks, and destructive scoring shows scratches, tear marks in the direction of sliding. So there is a lot of sliding also happening. Considerable amount material is removed from the detendum, and addendum parts shows distinct pitch line. So this is how basically it is a result of poor lubrication. So main cause is the heating of gear mesh, lubricant breakdown, or inadequate lubricant from the beginning. So that leads to excessive wear. Extreme pressure additives and high viscosity gear oils, which can withstand high temperature, is necessary to prevent scoring. Gear oil flow quantity and the direction of flow may help reduce temperature. So we have to do all that related to the lubricant. So try to keep the gears in the normal temperature. So we should not allow it to heat up, and we should make sure that lubrication is good. So if the problem persists, gear mesh should be redesigned to reduce stress, reduce pitch line velocity and inlet oil temperature. Localized scoring is a problem of manufacturing error, misalignment, gear shaft deflection, bore of the casing out of parallel, or gears may have helical angle error. So all these manufacturing error can also lead to high contact stress, and then lead to excessive wear. So these pictures show how to examine the pattern on the teeth of gear. So basically, we want to know if there is a high contact stress at localized area. So in that case, you can color them with some dyes. There's one dye which is known as dichem. It is a lacquer, and so you can color them and then run the gear at 25% load, 50% load, 75% load, and 100% load. And after running, you will see that the contact stress pattern will be clear. So you can see if at one point the stress is very high, so at that point the lacquer will be removed easily, and other areas the lacquer will not be removed, or paint will not be removed. So this is a method of examining the stress distribution on the gear teeth. In this slide, we can see that how the gear surface will look like because of any kind of error that is happening. So for example, A is load carrying pattern on gear rim with a wobbling pinion. So in this case, check pinion seat. So wobbling pinion will lead to this kind of pattern. load carrying pattern with wobble gear rim. So this is a B. So all these kind of pattern we will see that that happens in a gear which is not correct, which is defective, and often because of the manufacturing defects. So for example, in the D, pressure spot caused by production defect or thermal deformation of certain area. So here is the spot. So for example, you can see that these darker lines indicate some frequent contact, high contact stress. So these are the all signs that we can see on the gear surface, and we can identify whether it is a, what kind of problem there might be. So finally, for the gear tribology, tribological solutions for gear systems can be summarized into these three parts. The first one is the lubricant. So if the problem is happening because of lubricant, then increasing the viscosity of the lubricant and also using a high temperature lubricating oil or grease can be helpful. Use of extreme pressure additive should be used so that we can avoid boundary failure because of the failed boundary lubrication. So boundary lubrication can be improved. Filtration in gear oil change should be applied so that we avoid abrasive wear, and positive lube spray for good lubrication and for cooling can be employed. Manufacturing problems can come from incorrect alignment of the gear, so alignment of the gear should be correct. Alignment of the bores in the gear box should be correct so that everything is fully aligned, and involute shape of the tooth should be good so that we can avoid any excessive contact stress in a localized manner. The third part we should look at is the gear materials. So hardness and toughness of the gear material is very, very important. So hardness of the surface and toughness of the overall material like core. Depth of the surface hardening and case hardening is very, very important. And third, which is extremely important, is the clean steel. So nowadays for all gear manufacturing, we use clean steel. So steel must be clean. That means it should not have any kind of defect or inclusions inside, because those defects and inclusions will act as point of stress concentration, and therefore pitting and fatigue failure will initiate. So that's all for the gear tribology. You have any question?
One question, sir. Like, sir, our most of the cases, sir, gears are open, not in closed chamber, like in case of gear trains in automobiles and all. They are in closed system, but sir, many of the cases they are in not in closed system, sir. So how we can do lubrication of this type of gear?
Yeah, so that is a big problem. So one thing we should do is to reduce the stress. So design the gear such that the stresses are not too high, and you can increase the width of the gear to reduce the stress, right? And
sir, we have constraint now. We have to use for this this amount of power.
Within those constraints, so actually to make the gears very durable for long lasting, we have no option, but we have to have the gearboxes. We have to have the clean system. So for example, automotive systems come with this kind of gearboxes, and you can see that nowadays gears run for the whole life of the car. It doesn't get damaged unless some other problem comes, like corrosion or some other things. But for a normal operation of a car, the gear can last for the whole life of the car. That means life of the engine and life of other parts. So nowadays gear systems are really very robust, very durable. So depending upon the application, for if it is involves mobile system, it, if it involves like aerospace, they have to be maintained clean. So you have to have gearboxes. But for large industrial application, perhaps gearboxes are not possible. So in that case, you can just apply thicker grease, thicker oil, viscous oil, and do proper maintenance and cleaning more frequently. So next topic I would like to introduce is the seal. So today we will just introduce, and perhaps in the next lecture we will try to see how much we can finish, because next lecture is going to be the last lecture. So seals, as you already know, are to keep a process fluid from leaking between two stationary or one stationary and one rotating parts. So seals are important parts of many tribological systems such as pumps and bearings. So we always see that pumps as well as all kinds of bearings, they all have seals because they are dealing with liquids, liquid lubricants or some process fluid. So they have to have seals so that we can avoid any kind of leakage. So for example, a very simple example is when you pump air inside your bicycle. So you have got a piston, so piston goes up and down. But if there is a leakage between the cylinder and the piston, then it will not work. Your pump will not work very good. But if this is too tight, then again it will not work because you will have to apply very high load, as well as there will be some wear taking place between the piston and the cylinder. So seals are something that we want them to be tight fit so that they do not allow any fluid passing through between the shaft and the housing. But if it is too tight fit, then it will not allow the rotation of the shaft, and therefore there will be wear taking place. So for example, here is the seal, and the wear will take place in the seal or the shaft part. So we can understand the seals are extremely important because in some cases we might be dealing with hazardous liquids or oils. Oils are also not good for the environment in general. So if there is a leakage of these hazardous process fluid or oils from the pumps and from the bearings and other parts of the machine, then it will not be good for environment, as well as we are losing the liquid, we are losing the fluid. So from all consideration, the seals are very, very important part of our engineering system. So seals are of two types, static and dynamic. So static seals are the ones where the two surfaces are static, there is no movement between them. So therefore, any seal we apply, it remains there for its whole life. And there is no sliding taking place. So therefore, tribological issues are very, very minimum here. But in dynamic seals, where one surface is moving and another surface is stationary, so in that case, if one surface is moving, another is stationary, that means the seal has to do two things. One is to stop the fluid passing through here and allow this rotation to happen, allow this motion to happen. So these two things are achieved in dynamic seals. So normally there are two types of seals, static and dynamic. So static one is also known as gasket. And so our main concern will be the dynamic seals, because these are the systems where tribology plays an important role, and we need to find the proper solutions for sealing. So this gives an example of static seal gaskets. So you must have seen in any kind of pipes through which water or some other fluids flow through, and near the joints we use these kind of gaskets so that the fluid does not flow through. and there is no leakage. So this is the example of static one. In engine cylinder and head also there is a gasket here which is made of metals, and this gasket will basically prevents any leakage of the combustion gas going out from the cylinder out in the environment. So this is another type of gasket. So now dynamic or rotating seals. So here, as the name suggests, there is one static and one dynamic. So this is also known as rotating seals, and these are of two types, interfacial type and interstitials. So both does the same role, that means stopping the fluid flow, fluid leakage, and allowing for the motion between the shaft and the housing. But the interfacial one is has more distinct design. By design they are bit of distinction. So the interfacial seals are also known as contact seals. And interstitial seals are known as clearance seals. So in terms of function or the role, they are doing the same thing, but interfacial ones are distinctly different because of the design. So we will see that the two different types of seals. So here interstitial seals, bushing seals, labyrinth seals, visco and ferrofluidic seals, and here in the interfacial ones, axial and radial, and very important ones are the mechanical seals, then lip seals which are used in bearings, and packing seals. So this is all so far for today. So in the next lecture I will try to cover some part of the seals further.